First question we always ask here on the Born the Battle. First of all, thank you for being here. I appreciate you taking the time to do this. First question we always ask is, when and where did you know that military service was going to be the next step in your life?
So, and thank you for having me here. I'm really excited. So I was very fortunate to get something called the Health Profession Scholarship for my doctoral program. And really, prior to learning about that scholarship opportunity, I never, ever, ever thought I was going to be in the military.
So this was right out of high school?
This was actually in my doctoral program. So I was like 24, 25 when I applied for the scholarship. And I just had never thought that like the military would be a thing for me, or, you know, I just didn't imagine. I would say I didn't even have a very clear idea of what really happened in the military, like other than, you know, people go off somewhere and fight wars, but like really had no sense of the variety of jobs and opportunities and things like that. Yeah. And I was very fortunate to be awarded the scholarship. And ultimately, like, they pay for grad school and you pay them back with service time.
So did the Army send you to Nova Southeastern for your doctorate?
So I had already been accepted to Nova, and in the first year or so, I heard about the scholarship, which you typically apply for in your second year, or the scholarship starts in your second year. And Nova had historically had a student accepted for the scholarship like every year. So there were people a year or so ahead of me who were on the scholarship. And there was another student who was active duty, but on, I forget the official term, but like on release to go do civilian training in order to attend
temporary
graduate
duty.
School. Yeah. And so, you know, so I had the opportunity to talk to a lot of other people who were in service or in the scholarship program and kind of go from there.
Okay. So that's where you heard about it from other students.
Mm-hmm.
Got you. Nova Southeastern, is it university, college?
It's a university.
Yeah, yeah. Between Fort Lauderdale and Miami, not a bad place to do your doctorate, got to admit. That's where the entire country is going for spring break, and like you're living there.
Yeah, and I'm from Michigan. So, you know, you apply to grad school in the like fall and winter. And I got the acceptance letter, and it was like minus 30 degrees. Like it was the middle of a really bad polar vortex. And I was like, I am going to go to Florida, I think.
That's awesome. So you joined the, finished your doctorate, joined the Army. Mm-hmm. What years were you at Tripler and Walter Reed?
So my first year on active duty, I was at Fort Gordon. That was 98, 99. And then at the 25th, starting in 99 for about 2 years, and then at Tripler for another 2 years, finishing out my service obligation.
What year did you get out of the military?
In 2002.
Okay, so you were probably just starting to see veterans return from the initial, like, September 11th attacks and initial deployments.
So we really weren't seeing them at that point in time, especially because it was, you know, Pacific operations. And so the troops that were deploying weren't really coming from the Pacific area early on.
Gotcha.
So I didn't have, at that point in time, I did have veterans like coming out of Bosnia, for instance, and things like that, but not coming back from the Middle East at that point.
Okay. So what was behavioral health like that before, like before September 11th, and how has that changed?
So, you know, at the infantry division, because there really wasn't deployments happening, there wasn't the kind of op tempo that we've seen in the last almost 20 years now. It looked a bit different because, and these things still happen. Like we see people coming to their first duty assignment, and Hawaii is a long ways away from family and from the mainland, and there's a lot of cultural differences. So seeing people with adjustment issues, and then people with PTSD and other things, but I would say it was less prevalent than we see now because of the, you know, the intervening years that, and the things that have happened with the active duty folks since that time.
Gotcha. So you got out in 2002. While you were in, who would give me either your best friend or your greatest mentor?
Mm-hmm. So I would say my year group of like first year people that did internship with me at Fort Gordon were really good friends to me, because we were all kind of on the same, like experiencing the same things for the first time together. And I had a supervisor there named Gary Southall. He's a major at the time, and he got promoted along. And he actually PCS'd to Hawaii about the same time I did. So I continued to work with him. And he was a great mentor and really helpful to me in like learning, you know, how to be the division psychologist, which is very different from being a student or a graduate student or a student in training and internship.
So you went from Fort Lauderdale to Hawaii, not a bad place to like start a career. Not some bad places to start a career. What was your transition like for when you got out? Did you automatically end up at Easter Seals, or was there a career in between? How did you make that military transition initially?
So I was very, very fortunate in that I transitioned out to a civilian position doing exactly what I had been doing at Tripler. So that was working in the outpatient behavioral health clinic and in primary care as a psychologist. And so, you know, in terms of career transitions, it was also a little bit different, I would say, because I was a psychologist on active duty. That translates pretty easily to the type of work you would do as a civilian.
Sure.
Versus, you know, sometimes like some of the people that have careers that are more specific to the military, it's like you have to learn to speak a different language, even though the skills that a sergeant may have in the infantry about management and all of these things actually translate really well. Yeah, but it's often hard to sort of describe it in a way that employers understand or, you know, civilians understand. For a lot of the, I'll just use professional folks like doctors, psychologists, lawyers, in some ways the transition is a little bit easier because it's much more parallel to what the civilian counterparts may do. And I specifically came back to Tripler, like seeing the same clients that I had seen the week before. I just put on different clothes in the morning.
Oh, so you went back to the DOD as working the same gig. Interesting. Very interesting. Mm-hmm. How did you get out of that? What was the reason why would you leave the island, you know, Hawaii, and, mm-hmm. and now we're in Maryland?
So I was in a dual military family, and my husband was also active duty. Okay. And we sort of went back and forth about what to do as my service obligation, you know, was coming to an end. And he was a medical doctor, and so we knew that he was going to be PCS'd several times.
Yeah.
And we wanted to have children. So there was a lot of things that kind of went into the, you know, decision making about transitioning out. He had a much longer service obligation, so that was like not, yeah. It wasn't like he could get out and I could stay in. So in the interest of being able to be in the same place, they were talking about duty assignments for me that would not have been with him as my next PCS. And that wasn't compatible with having children.
Hats off for those that do the dual military and are able to do it for 20 years. It's a difficult gig sometimes.
It really is.
So you got out, you were working for the government, you were working for DOD. Was it a more compatible fit at that point for your family plan?
Yes, because then a year later, my husband and consequently I had a PCS, because he finished his training and went to his first operational assignment, which was at Fort Hood. Mm. And he deployed from there, shortly after we arrived.
Very good. Very good. How long did you work for the DOD?
So I worked at Tripler for a year, and then I was off and teaching some graduate courses and things like that because we kept moving, which uh-huh. is this challenge for military spouses. Like, you know, you move and it's so hard.
I'm surprised the DOD didn't move your job with you.
So we weren't exactly. I mean, you know, yeah. it's a difficult situation. And so, and I had a baby like just a little ways after we moved. And so it would have been complicated, but
sure,
the,
sure.
So I just, it was like hit or miss things that I did for a few years. And then when we got to, Maryland, and we had decided like this was going to be sort of our last stop.
Yeah.
This
is it.
I'm done PCSing. or at least like we're going to homestead for a while. And so, sure. I reached out. I was very fortunate that, you know, a lot of the people that I had worked with on active duty were here, on active duty, or students I knew that had also had, that I'd worked with or who had, been in the HPSP scholarship program, things like that. I just connected with the network again, and I was very fortunate to get hired at Walter Reed. So, you know, just came home basically to the same kind of work with the military, doing the work that I love, really.
So at that point, you must have seen the big shift in the types of therapy and the types of veterans returning from the wars. How is that stint at Walter Reed different than your initial stint at Tripler?
So definitely a big shift towards trauma type work, like PTSD type work post-deployment. And of course, at Walter Reed, it was where like most of the people that needed amputations or had really severe injuries were being sent for long periods of medical treatment. So that was very different than the types of folks that, you know, I was seeing initially in at Tripler when I had been there. And it had been about 5 years that I like wasn't seeing those kinds of patients. So there was a big shift over that course of time, because we're talking about 2002 to 2007. So 2007, yeah. We're in, you know, there had been surges and there had been, you know, really intense periods of combat that these soldiers, for the most part, at Walter Reed had gone through. And so a lot more trauma type work. And a lot of people that were in the like med board process and things like that. Sure. So, and that's further, you know, complicates the experience of what guys are going through.
Probably a sense of, for a lot of people, you know, worthlessness at that point, probably in their lives, being rejected almost, I'm sure.
Definitely. And, you know, it's a difficult thing. If you think, you know, for many of us, like a lot of meaning comes from our work and yeah. from our military service. And so to face not being able to do that. And a lot of times the medical board process, I don't think it's intended to be a rejection. It's a, you know, but it feels like a rejection. It can feel like being yeah. fired, like yeah. a very slow, drawn out firing, you know,
yeah,
and over the course of 2 or 3 years or something. And I mean, it's devastating. It's really difficult.
I've seen a lot of service members that feeling, and you want to help to, because it's like, that's not what it is. It's, you know, and then, you know, on top of that, maybe dealing with survivor's guilt and, you know, on all
Absolutely.
These different, PTSD, you know, symptoms that we saw, Okay, so you were at Walter Reed for how many years?
So I was at Walter Reed until 2017.
Gotcha. And, so 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So did you specialize in cognitive behavioral therapy the entire time? Gotcha. Were there different therapies that were being employed as well?
So, yes. So we talk about people having different like approaches or strategies to therapy. So some people may have more like psychoanalytic approach, or some people have, there's various like
humanistic and
different, exactly. Like different.
I have a very, very rudimentary, you know, initial class. So like, I don't know much about, I just know that there's different type of therapies for different things. And I just didn't know if the DOD and VA and, you know, is it just human or cognitive behavioral, or are they trying different things?
So the VA really focuses on providing evidence-based care. So they look at all the research that's out there on different treatments, say for PTSD,
yeah,
and the medications and the various types of therapy. The research really supports cognitive behavioral therapy or treatments that are like prolonged exposure therapy or cognitive processing therapy, that they are foundationally cognitive behavioral therapy. There's very specific treatment protocols in those two approaches. But so it's always been my thing, like from, you know, coming up through graduate school. In order to be, you know, the most effective providers and caretakers that we can to the veterans and active duty service members that are coming in, it really requires that you use evidence-based care and that you know the research, sure, and that you are able to apply those sure types of treatments.
Gotcha. In the therapy world, in the therapist world, psychologists, is it almost like I am X and this person is Y, and it's very segregated? Is it like based on the way that you're able to give care?
It's probably segregated makes it sound like we might not like each other.
Sure, sure.
you tend to have like kind of your approach, you know, and people might mix it up a little, like, you know, 3 cups CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, and like a pinch of humanistic or a pinch of something else. But people tend to kind of have the approach that makes sense to them and they're comfortable with and sort of stick with that.
Gotcha. Well, you are a cognitive behavioral therapist. Can you break down what that is?
Sure. So cognitive behavioral therapy. So I'm a licensed clinical psychologist. And I am trained in cognitive behavioral therapy. And
gotcha.
Fundamentally, what cognitive behavioral therapy says is our emotions, our feelings, like happy, sad, frustrated, angry, whatever, and our behavior. So I decided to lay in bed all day or something, come from our thoughts. And so something happens, a situation happens, we get stuck in traffic and we think something about being stuck in traffic. We think nothing ever goes right for me and we feel hopeless or defeated, or we think my boss is going to yell at me when I get to work and we felt anxious. And so the therapy focuses on, you know, what you're thinking and saying to yourself. If you're saying to yourself, my boss is going to fire me, is that accurate or not? Is it helpful? How can we kind of challenge it? And then what could you do or say that would be more helpful? And so cognitive behavioral therapists tend to like be really interested in that kind of chain of events, right? Something happens, you think something, you feel and do something in response to those thoughts.
Gotcha. So deep, deep unpacking of a initial thought that come to your brain.
Mm-hmm.
Very yes. good. Very good. Very good. How did you get to the Cohen Medical Family Clinic?
So I was at Walter Reed for a long time and it was great. And my coworkers were fantastic. I just occasionally would like sort of check out what else was going on. And the Cohen Clinic was getting ready to open. And I love the mission. I love that they serve everybody, regardless of their discharge status, regardless of their benefit status, because, you know, in the VA or in the DOD, you know, MTF system, you really only see people that have benefits. And there are a lot of veterans who don't. And often they may be the people that are most in need of help and behavioral health treatment. So I just was really attracted to it. And I was ready to, you know, just mix it up. I've been in one place for a long time to try something new. So that's how it happened.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Well, you've been the new director, I think, since August, right?
Yes.
August of 2020. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Are these clinics similar to VA vet centers? I see a lot of parallels with the VA vet centers, family therapy. And we did a benefits breakdown with the director for VA vet centers back in our archives as well. So if you're listening to that, please check that out. Are these similar to what those are?
So there's a couple differences. And one is, you know, typically to access the VA vet centers or anything that's VA associated, you have to have the VA benefits. The other is that we will see any family member, and that family member is as defined by the veteran. Mm-hmm. So, and we will see active duty and active duty family members. So someone who's living, you know, with their partner or girlfriend or boyfriend, that person is also eligible for services.
And we
serve children as young as 4 years old, which I don't think that the vet centers do, though I'm not 100% positive.
I know vet centers from what I got from that benefits breakdown that I referenced. Their director talked to me about if they're eligible for services, it's more of a prolonged care. But if they're not eligible for services, they'll still bring them in and then point them to someone like this clinic, that the Stephen Koenig Military Family Clinic, where they could get service. So there's still an initial service there, and they will get to people in the right direction. Do you guys have a close relationship with the vet centers?
We really do with the VA, the vet center, and since our clinic is local to Silver Spring and Walter Reed, we get referrals from all of those places. We know that the need exceeds the capacity of the system. And so we really work in cooperation with all of those other entities. So we are not part of the VA. So our records, for instance, don't, you know, connect in any way with the VA. So the VA doesn't see our notes. They don't know anything that's happening if somebody seeks care with us.
Gotcha. I know it's important for some. Mm-hmm. I had no idea that these clinics were a thing at all until David Muir, he brought it back up in his episode. And when we were talking about Easter Seals Veteran Staffing Network back in, I want to say it was in around episode 220. So if you're listening to this, check out that episode as well. He was talking about resources that Easter Seals had in that category for veterans and looking for a career. But yeah, I had no idea that these clinics were a thing until he brought it up. There's 16 of these clinics, right?
There's 19 now, and
19.
And they're expecting to have 25 open by about the end of the year this year. So it's been really rapid growth. Our clinic opened in 2017, which is when I came over as deputy director, and we were about the seventh clinic that opened at that time. So since 2017, an additional 12 clinics have already opened. It's really been very rapid expansion and growth.
You know, one nonprofit to fund 16, 19, 20, 20 clinics. You know, I'm seeing a lot of other nonprofits trying to build rehabilitation centers for homeless veterans, things like this. And many of them have a plan to have in-house mental health facilities. Because I think it's safe to say, and even the Secretary of Veterans Affairs, when I interviewed him, mental health, there's a shortage, not just in the military community, not just in the veteran community, but just overall, as mental health is becoming more and more accepted, it's becoming a scarcer and scarcer resource, I think, just in general. But it seems like, a lot of money is needed to run one of these.
My clinic is a collaboration between the Cohen Veterans Network and Easter Seals. In the other clinics, it's a collaboration between Cohen Veterans Network and another local community partner that serves either mental health or veterans that then agreed to this partnership in order to open these clinics. So Easter Seals has this clinic. The other 19 have different community partners, with the Cohen Veterans Network as the sort of umbrella under which we all fit.
Interesting. So Cohen's Veteran Network is different than Easter Seals.
Correct. So it's a collaboration between the two. And Steve Cohen is sort of originated this with very generous grant to stand up these clinics, because his son served in the Marines and came back with, you know, trauma and things from his experiences. And, you know, in talking with his father about like the difficulty that he was seeing his fellow Marines have in getting care, and that there really needs to be additional options and resources out there, that led to, you know, establishing the Cohen Veterans Network and this network of clinics.
Yeah. I mean, just due to the scarcity of mental health facilities and like I said, would you agree that it's not just a military and veteran population problem of not having enough mental health, but just an overall population?
Oh, I would absolutely agree. And I say within the profession, we kind of, that's been a known thing for a few decades even. and it's difficult because graduate school is very expensive. It's difficult to afford. There are not enough opportunities for people to get graduate education. Like, there's not enough programs. And so there's like a pipeline issue of getting people into the profession. It's definitely not just the military. But then whenever you're dealing with like a special population, like the military, you're looking for like a really special subset of people that provide behavioral health services, for instance.
Sure. So there's a pipeline issue. Is there once you're through the pipeline, is there a capacity issue to get hired?
Because of that pipeline, it's not terribly difficult to get hired. Like, I think it's a seller's market a little bit for, people who are interested in working in the field.
Very interesting. Very interesting. I always like to learn about different industries and how it's going and stuff like that. Very interesting. How has treatment been in the age of COVID with mental health treatment going to telehealth, and how has your clinic been able to adapt to that?
So prior to a year ago, we already had telehealth services, and about 30-40% of our clients were already using telehealth, which was so fortunate in hindsight, because we knew how to do it. We didn't have everybody, not all of our clients knew how to do it, but 30 to 40% did. So in about a week, we were able to just do a total 180 and have 100% of the people transition to telehealth. And what really changed for our clinicians was working from home, because we had always been based in the clinic. But we've definitely seen an increase in requests for services. We've seen prior clients that had, you know, been discharged in the last 3 years returning for additional services.
Sure.
We're seeing more intense symptoms and a higher rate of people reporting like suicidal ideation and things. When about a 30% increase in the frequency that people are reporting.
30%.
Yeah. It's been a tough year for everybody.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Your tempo is probably just spiked.
We're busy. I mean, we definitely, keep the schedule full, and we're also aware that people are staying a little longer in treatment, you know, by a session or two, I think because of the the increased sort of intensity of symptoms that people are experiencing right now. It will be interesting to look back on this when it's really truly behind us to see how it's changed things and what's happened with, you know, with this experience.
Sure, sure. What's been the biggest difference between treating veterans now versus your active duty during the active duty, like military? What are some different, are there any different, and I'm sure COVID has probably skewed this a little bit, but is there any different type of things that are popping up that you would see in a veteran that normally you wouldn't see, that you would see that would be different in active duty?
So one of the big differences for veterans versus active duty is that you're more likely to have like employment issues, transition issues, homelessness, yeah, financial issues, food insecurity, that, you know, you're fairly protected from when you're on active duty because you have housing and you have access to medical care and things like that. So we know that part of the thing that's so nice about Easter Seals is we really have these wraparound services that include things like you talked to Dave from Veteran Staffing Network. We have employment, we have case management, we have the veterans homeless vets reintegration program. We have a lot of wraparound services because these behavioral health problems don't exist like in some kind of isolation. They exist in the context of these other challenges, like life stressors and things happening. And those effects have been magnified by COVID, and they've been magnified even more so for veterans. So like the impact of unemployment for COVID is magnified for the veteran population. It's worse, higher rates than compared to the general population. So, you know, that's contributes to what we see and the needs that we see that with people coming in for the support that they need.
Within cognitive behavioral therapy, what's been a prevalent or more a very successful type of treatment that you've seen with veterans?
Mm-hmm. So both cognitive processing therapy and prolonged exposure therapy are like the gold standard treatments for PTSD. That is, they have very strong scientific evidence around their efficacy. Okay. I love both of them. I'm certified in both of them because it's very rewarding to work with somebody who's really been struggling over the experiences that they've had in the past and help them, you know, process that, make sense of it, and reduce their symptoms of PTSD and see the quality of life improvements.
Can you give me an example of each?
Yeah, I can give you like I'll give you a real short thumbnail and you may have tons more questions, but the VA has a fantastic website with PTSD resources and lots of information about these treatments. Cognitive processing therapy is a 12-session manualized treatment. That means like kind of, it's almost like a syllabus. You know, you go through session one, you cover certain things. Session two, you cover certain things. And okay, it's looking at that thought piece of that situation, thought, emotion, behavior chain that I talked about. It's very, very focused on the thought piece.
Okay.
And prolonged exposure is very, it's also a cognitive behavioral therapy, but it's focused on the action piece of that chain. So we say situation, thought, and then emotions and behavior. So prolonged exposure therapy gets really focused on that behavior piece, including like ruminative, you know, intrusive memories that are such a part of PTSD. So they're both cognitive behavioral therapies. They just work on different parts of the chain.
Gotcha. Prolonged exposure, is that kind of like, hey, I have anxiety going into an interview, so I'm just going to go into a many, many different interviews and just kind of get used to being that in that uncomfortable space?
That is a piece of it. Absolutely. Though you don't start at the hardest thing. You start at like, you know, kind of a lower midpoint and you work your way up through those things. And you also work your way up through the memories around the traumas.
Okay. Very interesting. Very interesting. So I wasn't aware of this until someone within your office told me that April is an awareness month for, you know, April's an awareness month for many things, but it's also the month of the military child. And you talked about how your clinic is eligible for veterans' family members as well. Concerning the veteran, what are some basic principles that a veteran's family can do to help the veteran and their family?
So do you mean what the family can do to support the veteran or all around?
All around. Cause I think that it can also go both ways, right? Like the veteran has to support those family members too, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
So much of what we work on, a lot of times comes down to good communication skills, right? Like working on being able to like non-defensively listen to your partner or your other family member and be able to make requests in a way that's effective and positive. So I think that, you know, whether you're coming in for assistance with that or it's something that you just need to start noticing and paying particular attention to, that's kind of a foundational thing to having that support is being able to ask for it in a way that people can respond and hear what you need, being able to listen in a way that's effective as other people are communicating with you. So, and we do, you know, it's a common theme that comes up both in individual and family and couples therapy and some of the workshops and groups and things like that that we do as well.
How do you help the communicate, like when it comes to a four-year-old, you talk about helping four-year-olds in family therapy. Where does the military child come to play in that type of family therapy?
So, I mean, sometimes it's parenting skills for the parent. Sometimes it's helping. You can do cognitive behavioral therapy with a four-year-old, right? Like learning to label emotions, like rather than, you know, kids tantrum, and they all do sometimes, like even we do sometimes as adults, right? Yeah. But sometimes that's about not being able to like effectively describe what's happening for you, like what's upsetting you or what you need in that moment. And that's something that you can work on even with four-year-olds, you know? So a lot of this comes down to, and parents can learn to help kids do that too. Cause like sometimes, you know, with the tantrum, you might just walk away, right? Yeah. And that sometimes is effective, but sometimes you need to like model how to talk to a kid about, or to talk about feelings and help kids learn to do that thing. So again, this comes down to parenting skills, teaching the child particular communication skills.
There's classes that are labeled communications, but what you get a lot of times is like marketing communications or different modes, like technical modes, like through the, you know, spoken word or writing, or, you don't get how to communicate.
Exactly. So when I say communication, I'm talking about like, how do you resolve a dispute with your spouse, you know, or your partner? And, and it's very helpful to learn those skills. It really helps build a relationship and things. And people shouldn't feel bad for not knowing how to do it, because if you're not taught it and it's not modeled to you necessarily, how in the world would you know how to do it? You just, you know,
trial and error and experience and based on what you saw, I guess, as a child, you know, really.
Right. Which isn't always a great model for a lot of people.
No, not always.
Yeah.
Interesting. Interesting. That is very interesting that, you know, it's like, we talk about all the things that you should be taught in high school, you know, when it comes to, you know, personal financial stability, or I haven't thought about like interpersonal communication skills, type of class. Very interesting.
How to have a good relationship. It's never taught.
Yeah. Interesting. Doctor, what's one thing that you learned during your time in the military that you apply to what you do today?
God, it was so formative for me. You know, there were so many things that it's sometimes hard to describe. So I started out by saying I didn't really know about the military. You know, even when I got the scholarship, I didn't have an idea of like what was really involved. I So I'm going to say it sounds a little cheesy, but I feel like patriotism is what I learned. I'm like, oh. About what service really is. Sorry.
No, you're fine. No, you're good. It seems like that hit a node.
Yes, it did. I think both because the service has been very meaningful to me, but to see the sacrifice that our service members make for this country.
Well,
sorry.
No, you're fine. Don't forget that you and your family were part of that too. And I appreciate you as well.
Thank you.
And now, you work for Easter Seals, but is there a veteran nonprofit or a veteran in the community whom you've worked with or you've had an experience with that you'd like to mention?
So for like client reasons, I can't, say anything specific about people I've worked with. Sure. There's definitely, I would say the vast majority of my experiences are deeply rewarding. I love the work that I do. I wouldn't keep doing it if it wasn't so meaningful. So there's been numerous people that I would identify in that way. And there's so many great veteran organizations. We have a great relationship with Serving Together. They do tremendous work. Blue Star Families, Yellow Ribbon Fund. I mean, there's so many great organizations, and they've been for the most part established and stood up by veterans and military families, because they believe in, giving back to these people that have sacrificed in their own service.
Yeah. Gotcha. Mm-hmm. I can tell the passion, and I appreciate it. I do. I really do.
Thank you.
Doctor, Vandenbroek,
or just Doc,
works. Okay. we've covered a little bit of ground today. Is there anything that I haven't asked that you think it's important to share for anybody that's listening?
I think the one thing is to really destigmatize seeking mental health care. It's so important, and it's treated like it's different than medical care. Behavioral health care is medical care. If you sprained your ankle, you would take care of it. You wouldn't feel like embarrassed or ashamed to go, get an x-ray, get it checked out, wear one of those like weird orthopedic boots, if you need to. And I'd really like to see seeking behavioral health treatment to be the same way that we think about taking care of ourselves. We think about if you have diabetes, you check your blood sugar, you take medication you need to do, and nobody feels embarrassed about that. Or if you have high blood pressure, that you do it. If something, you have a weird mole, you go get it checked out. That we really should be like recognizing if you've got stress and things are happening, go get it checked out.
Yeah. Or if it just comes into being, even when it comes to physical health, we talk about just getting an annual checkup, go get your annual checkup,
Right.
And you're right. We don't think about mental health in that way.
Right. It doesn't even get called we talk about going to the doctor. It gets like siloed off as it's like something separate from medical care. It is medical care. It's part of our overall wellness, just like the annual physical.